Good morning again. And yes, the former Secretary of State is with us in the studio this morning, his first Sunday interview in about 1 year exactly. Well, Mr. Secretary, let's get right down to it. A lot of people are talking about and assessing the situation in Iraq. We just had the James Baker, Lee Hamilton Commission say that, quote, the situation was dire and getting worse. What is your assessment?
I agree with the assessment of Mr. Baker and Mr. Hamilton. It's grave and deteriorating. And as Secretary Designate of Defense Bob Gates said at his confirmation hearing, we're not winning. So if it's grave and deteriorating and we're not winning, we are losing. We haven't lost. And this is the time now to start to put in place the kinds of strategies that will turn this situation around. It's a war that's unfolded really in three phases. Phase one was the march to Baghdad and the removal of the Saddam Hussein regime and the destruction of that army. That was done very, very well. We thought that was it, though. Phase two then began, the destruction of ministries, the burning down of buildings, the disorder in the streets. We didn't establish security in the communities of Iraq. And then that led to an insurgency. After 3 years, we still are not on top of that insurgency. But the most serious phase began earlier this year, phase three, with the blowing up of the Golden Mosque in Samarra. And that turned it into sect-on-sect violence, communitarian violence, which I think is degenerated into what some of us are calling, anyway, a civil war. And it is very difficult to see how the American Army, the United States Armed Forces, can impose its will on this kind of conflict, the phase three conflict. And we still haven't settled phase two. So I think it's a very serious situation, and it is not just an American strategy that's needed. It is an Iraqi strategy. How are the Iraqis going to deal with it? Because ultimately, I think the Iraqis are the key to the solution. And what I'm sure President Bush is trying to come up with over the next several weeks is how can American strategy and American efforts support the Iraqi strategy?
Well, you said some time ago that it had reached the stage of a civil war. What made you use that term?
I watched it all year long, from the blowing up of the mosque to the present. And for a while I said, well, it's sect on sect, it's communitarian violence. But when I see a situation where the government is having difficulty extending control, it's essentially in the green zone, where you have a situation like just in the last 24 hours, 51 dead people show up who have been murdered and assassinated, and another two dozen have been kidnapped this morning, and three more American soldiers have been killed in the last 24 hours, and nothing seems to be improving. It seemed to me that this looks like a civil war, and we ought to call it that. But there was another reason. I was looking for a way to make it a stark situation so that we would get the kind of response that I think is needed to deal with this situation that is deteriorating.
Well, let's talk about where we go from here. The president is apparently considering options. There seems to be stories leaking out now that perhaps he's talking about something like John McCain has been proposing, and that is a temporary surge, put in more troops, 20, 30,000 troops into Baghdad. The Baker Commission, of course, took just the opposite tack. They said we need to start drawing down eventually. What do you think we ought to do?
Over this summer, the United States and Iraqi forces launched Operation Forward Together. It began in June, and then phase two began in August, with thousands of American troops going into Baghdad to try to stabilize the situation. They haven't stabilized the situation. So we have tried this surge of troops over the summer. I am not persuaded that another surge of troops into Baghdad for the purpose of suppressing this communitarian violence or civil war will work. But if somebody proposes that additional troops be sent, if I was still chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, my first question to whoever is proposing it is, what mission is it these troops are to accomplish? Is it to secure Baghdad? In which case, the American Army isn't large enough to secure Baghdad, and we should not use our troops as policemen. It is to take over, is it to take over a certain section of Baghdad? Is it to go after the insurgents? There needs to be a clear mission that these additional troops are going to be performing. Secondly, can they accomplish that mission? Once you've set it out, is it something that really is accomplishable? And third, do we have enough troops to accomplish it? And we have to be very, very careful in this instance, not just to grab a number out of the air. It really has to be analyzed. General Abizaid said in his testimony just a few weeks ago, the Central Command commander, that he didn't see a need for more troops. I'm not sure that any of the commanders have said that yet. We hear from the Iraqi leadership that they want to take control of Baghdad, not bring in more American troops. We hear from Prime Minister Maliki, standing next to President Bush in Amman, Jordan, a couple of weeks ago, that he believes Iraqi forces will be able to take over all security by June. Now, I don't know if they really can do that or not, or whether they can secure Baghdad by themselves. But this is the time to say to them, fine, you think you can do that. Show us not only the political will to do that, show us the political means you're going to use. How are you going to go about reconciliation? How are you going to get the parties together and stop fighting one another? How are you going to do that? Because you need a political process to go along with the buildup of their military forces, and especially the buildup of their police forces, which is the weak link in all of this. It is the D.C. police force that guards Washington, D.C., not the troops that are stationed at Fort Myer. And in Baghdad, you need a police force to do that. In the other cities, you need a police force to do that, and not American troops. So before I would add any additional troops or recommend it to a commander-in-chief, I'd want to make sure we have a clear understanding of what it is they're going for, how long they're going for. And let's be clear about something else, Bob, that gets a little confusing. There really are no additional troops. All we would be doing is keeping some of the troops who were there longer and escalating or accelerating the arrival of other troops.
Well, let me just ask you about that, because do we have the troops? You seem to be suggesting that we don't.
I'm suggesting that what General Shoemaker said the other day before a committee looking at the Reserve and National Guard, that the active army is about broken. General Shoemaker is absolutely right. And all of my contacts within the Army suggest that the Army has a serious problem in the active force, and it's a problem that will spread into the Guard and Reserves. Backlog of equipment that is not being repaired. Soldiers, especially officers and non-commissioned officers, going on repetitive tours. So if you surge now, you're going to keep troops who have already been kept there long, even longer, and you're going to be bringing in troops from the United States who are going to be coming anyway, but perhaps a little bit later. And so that's how you surge, and that surge cannot be sustained. The current active army is not large enough, and the Marine Corps is not large enough for the kinds of missions they're being asked to perform. And we need to let both the Army and the Marine Corps grow in size, in my military judgment. And the Congress has a serious task ahead of it to make sure that the Army and the Marine Corps get the funds they need to sustain themselves and to sustain their equipment, their ammunition, everything else they need, if they're going to be put in these kinds of situations.
General, is that why, because the Army is the size it is, that we didn't have more people going in the beginning for the invasion?
Well, there were enough people for phase one. We took care of the regime in the Army. I don't think there were enough people for phase two. And it was not just a matter of not enough troops, because there were troops heading in and they were stopped from coming in, because the political judgment was made in the Pentagon that additional troops were not needed, we would build up the Iraqi forces quickly. But that didn't happen, and as a result, we saw disorder. And the first responsibility of any government, and we became the government the day that Saddam Hussein's regime fell under international law, and the first responsibility of a government is to provide security for the people. And what the people did not get in that second phase, and what they don't have now, is security to go about reconstruction, to go about building. So you see that mixed neighborhoods are ethnically cleansing themselves now, and tens upon tens of thousands of Iraqis have left the country because of lack of security. So the number one priority,
6 million, I think.
The number one priority has to be working with the Iraqi government and their strategy, provide security for the people of Baghdad initially. That's the center of gravity. But I think ultimately, with our help, it has to be done by the Iraqis. They're the ones who have to solve this internecine civil war, communitarian conflict that they're in.
Well, let's